For the last 23 years, just about every Sunday, I have been teaching God's word somewhere in some ministry. Relatively few exceptions over those 23 years, and of course the last almost 11 years have been right here at Calvary Chapel, Lake Elsinore. As I've done here for almost 11 years, I have done for the entire 23, and that is teach through the books of the Bible, chapter and verse. I recognize that this pulpit is not mine. You could say it's not even Calvary Chapel of Lake Elsinore's. It's the Lord's, and this church is the Lord's, and I take that seriously. There's only been one time in those 23 years that I ever departed from our book study that we were in to give a message specifically that week. That one time was after the attack on September 11th, 2001. It wasn't here, but at the other church where I was preaching. Well, this week is going to be the second time in 23 years. And again, it's because I have felt a burden from the Lord to share what I am going to share with you. I like to think that if I had been preaching in the days that President John F. Kennedy was assassinated, or Martin Luther King was assassinated, or after the Pearl Harbor attack, or other times in our history, that I likewise would deviate from whatever book of the Bible I might have been to address what was the consuming news of the day. And not just an event, but also the times in which we've lived. For certainly the years, for example, leading up to the Civil War, as preachers around the country thundered against slavery and the evil of that sin, I would like to think that I would be joining them at that time. And it is my fear, though I recognize I am not a prophet, that this nation's house, which is already very much divided, is on a path towards what could only be called a second civil war, unless there are some changes. And I think we need to recognize why. It was easy when we were talking about slavery and states' rights over 150 years ago or so. But what about today? There are three foundational pillars for any nation to be blessed by God. Those are faith, family, and the rule of law. We probably don't need to speak too much about faith, because it's not just religion of any sort. No, faith in the true and living God, in Jesus Christ. As the Bible tells us in the Psalms, blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. Jesus said, God is spirit, and he who would worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. And of course, later Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father except through me. To be blessed by God, obviously a nation must worship the true and living God. But also the importance of family. And once more, we probably don't need to expound on that too much. We see from the very beginning of God's creation the importance of marriage. As the first man and woman were created, and God brought them together in marriage, Adam and Eve. And in marriage, he then said, now, be fruitful, multiply, bring forth children into this world. And throughout the Bible, we have instruction about the importance of teaching our children about the things of God, raising our children in the way they ought to go to know God and so forth. We see the importance of marriage and God's hatred of divorce. We even see terms like adultery and fornication used to describe when God's people are rebelling against him, disobeying him. And likewise, we see marriage used to describe God's wonderful relationship and union with his people when we're walking with him and so forth, how we are married. And so obviously the family is so important for any nation, any society. But also the rule of law is that third pillar. And God is very clear on this in his word as well. Now notice I didn't say government. Government is far too broad of a term, because government would include all of the evil, brutal dictators throughout history. And as you read in the scriptures throughout the Old Testament, you see God overthrowing wicked, evil dictators and using people, sometimes God's people, sometimes the pagans, to do that work. So the idea that God ordains and approves wicked tyranny is far from Scripture. The rule of law is a different thing. And in the New Testament, of course, as Christians, we are told, obey the laws of the land, rightfully so. We are also told to pray for our leaders who rule over us. And what is that prayer motivated by? That we, church, might live quiet lives of peace in all godliness and reverence. They just leave us alone and we can enjoy our lives and worship God and pray for that. And of course, the Bible also tells us, we see this in the book of Acts, that on occasion, man's laws will go against God's laws. And on those rare occasions, man's laws should be challenged and God's law should be obeyed. See, the founders of this nation understood that biblical reality. The Declaration of Independence speaks of the fact that, first of all, we have a creator, that we're here because of God. And God, our Creator, has given us certain inalienable rights. That this is a self-evident truth. It's not really open to debate. It's clear to everybody that by means of our creation by God, we have the right to life, liberty, the pursuit of happiness. I would argue the pursuit of happiness means, for example, that you could take your family out to dinner without being harassed and insulted by an angry mob. And it certainly would mean that you could walk down the street wearing a red baseball hat with a campaign slogan without a complete stranger just slugging you in the face because your hat offends him. So our rights then are secured by government, that governments exist to protect the rights that God has given us. Therefore, our rights tell us that government is limited. Now, when we talk about the pursuit of happiness and liberty, we also recognize that we have responsibilities. There are boundaries upon the degree to which we say, well, I'm just pursuing happiness. I can do whatever I want. No, no, no. And those boundaries are the rule of law, also ordained by God. So we have rights that government is supposed to protect. We have responsibilities by which we are to submit the rule of law. But there's a third category, and that would be privileges. Privileges like, in this country, the ability to vote for our leaders. It's not really a right. It can be taken away. You do something wrong, commit crimes, so you can lose your right to vote. We call it a right to vote, but it's really a privilege, isn't it? There are other privileges, you know, driver's license, so forth. But we have these privileges. And in all of this, we are to be stewards in God's sight for what we've been given. For the United States, our nation is a very unique nation in the history of the world. Because really, other than Israel, as you look at your Bible, the United States is really the only other nation that from its beginning, from its settling and founding and establishing, was being established by mostly God's people seeking to live and for Him and worship Him. And you know the bravery, you know the hardships that the initial pioneer settlers experienced crossing the Atlantic Ocean in the voyage to get to this land with nothing awaiting them except, you know, a rush to build shelter and find food and the rest. Doing so for their Christian freedoms, their desire to worship God and establish a just society. In fact, some of the writings of those guys, if you read them, they saw themselves as a new Israel being established. That was their mindset that they had at that time. And of course, including that mindset was to share the gospel as Jesus commanded, go into all the world, to share the gospel with whatever residents were already native in this land. And they sought to do that. There was a desire to live together. Now, we know from the pages of history that that was not always, unfortunately, possible. And I'm not here in this message going to expand on history on either side of that issue. But we recognize the scripture does speak about God giving the land to the nations and dividing them as he will. Those settlers eventually became colonists of England, multiple colonists, different colonies, which eventually became a new nation as the Declaration of Independence affirmed, as they threw off British tyranny and they fought a war that led to victory. And any objective study of the history of this country, going all the way back then to the present day, would see that the United States and the colonies and the settlers before that all were, have been, and still are a strongly Christian people. Not everybody, but certainly the Christian influence. A nation consists of the people within the nation. So rather than talk about a Christian nation, you talk about the Christian people in a nation. And that has been true of this country. Like I say, I think only a argumentative or a fool would challenge that. But times are changing in this country. I don't put a lot of stock in polls, but one poll that is always fascinating to me, and I always check it out thoroughly, are the exit polls that they publish after national elections. Not the night of when the media is trying to spin stuff, but after the dust settles, you can look at how people identify themselves and then who they voted for. And it's fascinating. Back in 2004, 10% of the voters said they have absolutely no religion whatsoever. Just absolutely nothing. No, not just Christian, but no religion whatsoever. 10%. In this last presidential election, 2016, that number increased to 15%. And remember, statistics class, don't say, oh, wow, an increase of 5%. No. That's an increase of 50%. When you go from 10 to 15, a 50% increase. No religion whatsoever. On top of that, you of course have people who might identify with a religion, whether it be Christian or other, but they're not really serious about it. And they actually admit, I never ever attend any religious services whatsoever. So that doesn't just include the atheists, that includes a group in addition. And of that group, the same 50% increase from 2004 to 2016, just 12 years, takes place, but the number is higher. In 2004, it was 15%. In this last election, 22%. Let that sink in. Almost one out of every four voters have absolutely no basis for any sort of moral compass other than their own sinful nature in their heart. No connection whatsoever. And, you know, the church statistics, which you can research, say a similar story. There is no question at all that the influence in churches throughout this nation has been declining for many years. It has nothing to do at this point with salvation. You know, no one's going to judge whether someone's saved or not, but the simple statistics about commitment when it comes to attending worship services, financial giving, serving, and the like, there is no question that things are down. And I don't think if we just asked the question that anyone would argue that the church is a lot stronger today than it was, let's say, 50 years ago, 100 years ago, 150 years ago. Again, that argument really would be rather foolish. Now, I've noticed, thanks to the internet, as I read articles, and of course you read all the comments on the articles, that there is a trend these days. A trend that expresses itself almost as a hyper-spirituality. Like the true follower of Jesus Christ will not dirty their hands with anything that might be labeled politics, patriotism, or any such thing. So for years, Christians, for example, had no problem with a Pledge of Allegiance, you know, one nation under God, indivisible, liberty and justice for all. Oh, well, you know, a real follower of Jesus Christ would never say that. That's the trend. And that trend expresses itself to voting. Well, you can't vote. All these people are terrible. And if I had a dollar for every time I heard or read someone say, well, there's a lot of Christians out there that are confusing the cross with the American flag, I could retire early. And it is such a foolish statement. Along the lines also that you hear when they say, our Savior is supposed to be Jesus Christ, not some politician. Well, obviously, and no one is even remotely suggesting otherwise. Those are such silly, frankly, stupid statements to be made. But they influence a lot of people, and they're on the internet. And you know, the thing is, they're so foolish that the church has never really addressed those things. You can find 100 articles, don't say the Pledge of Allegiance if you're a Christian. You're not going to find 100 articles say, why you should say the Pledge of Allegiance. What's wrong with that? You see, yes, we are a citizen, our citizenship is in heaven. Absolutely. But we also have an earthly citizenship. I mean, that's without debate. We're members, if you will, of two kingdoms, a heavenly kingdom and an earthly kingdom. And you know, the same person, the Apostle Paul, who wrote, our citizenship is in heaven, is also someone who was a Roman citizen himself, which was rare in the time of the Bible. The early Christians, like the disciples of Jesus there in Galilee and so forth, they were not Roman citizens, they were Roman subjects. Paul was a Roman citizen, and he was freeborn. He didn't like buy his citizenship or bribe someone. He was a Roman citizen, and you know what you see when you study Paul's life? You see him standing on and exercising his legal rights as a Roman citizen and a follower of Jesus Christ when those rights were under attack. And you don't see Peter or someone say, now, Paul, you're supposed to be a Christian. You know, what are you getting political for? You see it when Paul appeals to Caesar, when he's being a political pawn, being shuffled around from prison to prison. You see it when they try to strike him. You know, they hit him. Hey, it's a right for you to hit a Roman citizen. I haven't had trial or anything. Like, whoa, man, I didn't know he was a Roman citizen. We're in trouble. Because it was a serious thing. The rule of law, serious thing. And Paul took it seriously. And what I notice in recognizing this trend that I'm speaking of, coupled with the weakness of the church, it's a disconnect, isn't it? I mean, in other words, if the same people who were so negative about, you know, saying or doing anything that could remotely be called political, if they were leading thousands of people to Christ and there was this huge revival going on in the land, then maybe we might listen to them a little bit more. But why this trend to stay out of all that stuff, even as the church is also getting weaker and weaker nationwide? And of course, as government gets bigger and bigger and reaches more and more, is there really an issue that you can talk about that couldn't be spun as being political? I mean, if the church can't talk about abortion, because, well, you know, you're getting political now, then God help us all. Because we are supposed to be the moral stand to the world, rooted in the authority of God's word and who God is. And I am reminded of a story. Some of you may know this story. A man who was a little boy at the time in Germany during the Nazi rule, going to a church there in Germany, Christian church, that happened to be located near the railroad tracks. And trains would go by on the railroad tracks. And he said, one day we realized that on that train, it was loaded with Jews crying and sobbing and pleading for someone to help, stuffed in like cattle on their way to their death, to the camps. And we found that out, that that was taking place, and we heard their cries. And so then every time the train whistle blew near our church, we knew who was on there. We knew who was on that train. We knew what was about to happen. And so we were instructed at our church, whenever it was about time for the train to come by, and boy, one thing Hitler did was have the trains run on time. That would be when we would sing hymns. And when the train actually came by, we would all sing a little bit louder to try to drown out the noise of the train and what it was saying in conviction to our hearts while we did nothing in the name of Jesus. Didn't want to be political, I guess. You look at our history, and I recognize, even as I speak, of what a great country the United States is, that we have certainly had problems. And the biggest evil, sin, in this nation's history that was allowed at the very start is the sin of slavery. Slavery was opposed by many people. The nation almost didn't get found. The Constitution almost didn't get ratified. There was so much opposition to slavery. But sadly, a compromise was made. And you cannot make a compromise with evil without one day it coming and to bring its reckoning. And it certainly did 100 or so years later, a little less than that, in the Civil War. But there were men, many of them. A few names you might know: John Wesley, Charles Finney, Charles Haddon Spurgeon in England, the other two in America. And these men preached Jesus Christ and Him crucified. They preached the gospel. They had some differences of opinion theologically among themselves, if you know their belief system. But one thing they were united on was their preaching of the cross. And another thing they were united on was their absolute hatred of slavery. And they preached against it often. It was an evil. It could not be tolerated. God would bring judgment if it wasn't dealt with. These three men taught that. And by the way, these three men, if you're familiar at all with their names, led countless numbers of souls to Jesus Christ. These were three of the most effective preachers and evangelists in the history of the world at that time. And I go back to my statement of, you know, if people were leading souls to Christ like Wesley and Spurgeon did, then maybe I might listen to them when they talk about their ideas about politics. But these men were political because there was an evil that had to be addressed, and God's people need to take a stand for righteousness. And they recognized that. In fact, that was true really of the whole abolitionist movement. Sadly, the pages of history get kind of whitewashed about the influence, the impact that Christians had on the abolitionist movement to get rid of slavery once and for all. Now, one aspect of that history that there's just no way they could ever rub it out and erase it had to do with a certain book written by a certain lady, Harriet Beecher Stowe. The book is called Uncle Tom's Cabin. It's my understanding that in the 19th century, 1800s, that other than the Bible, this book sold more copies than any other book in the world. It was definitely instrumental in ultimately bringing on what would be the Civil War and ultimately the outlaw of slavery. Even Abraham Lincoln said so. And it's a book written with a strong Christian message by a devout follower of Jesus Christ, Mrs. Stowe, who, by the way, was the daughter of devout followers of Jesus Christ. I guess she didn't buy into the don't get political thing. Christians have worked to right America's wrongs throughout history. We can expand down to the civil rights movement 100 years later. And we can look around the world as well. How many followers of Jesus Christ shed their blood on the beaches of Normandy? Over in Europe, over in the Pacific Ocean, to try to rid the world of fascism and tyranny. Many, not all, but many of those who made the ultimate sacrifice did so as followers of Jesus Christ. You could fast forward to a man like President Ronald Reagan. Absolutely hated communism and used the power and authority of his office to help ultimately bring it to an end, at least in terms of the Soviet Union and their influence that they had throughout the Cold War. There's some news about Ronald Reagan that's relatively recent. They've discovered a long-lost letter that Ronald Reagan wrote to his father-in-law, Nancy's dad, who was a devout atheist. And I'm not talking like, oh, I wonder if he's saved or not. This is one of those guys, I deny the deity of Jesus Christ, I deny the resurrection, I deny heaven and hell, it's all nonsense. He was one of those guys. And he got sick, worried about him dying. And they found a private letter that Reagan wrote this man, urging him to give his life to Jesus Christ, urging him to find the Savior before it's too late. Nancy finishes the story. She says, the weekend that her dad died, 2 days before, he called in the hospital chaplain. She says, I don't know what their conversation was, but I know my dad was at peace like I'd never seen him before when he died. Praise the Lord. Now, Ronald Reagan was not a perfect man. And you know what? No Christian is. God has a way of using imperfect vessels, doesn't he? But we are God's vessel. We don't belong to ourselves. We're told we're bought with a price. We belong to him. We are to be used by him as he leads and guides us, and we are to be stewards of everything that we are given. And I would argue that includes stewards of our citizenship in this unique nation. And unlike what we were talking about earlier, when you think about a follower of Christ like Corrie Ten Boom, who, along with her family, risked their lives and ultimately, other than Corrie, paid the ultimate price by losing their lives in the concentration camps for trying to protect the Jews. That's not our risk. We're not trying to overthrow some wicked tyrannical government by undermining and being part of a resistance movement or something like that. No. We can make a difference simply by voting. By expressing our freedom of expression, you know, calling a congressman, giving your point of view on something. But what we've seen this past week or so is not simple good old American freedom of expression, good old First Amendment stuff. No, this is not what America is to be all about, and it's certainly not what Christ following is all about. We looked at mob behavior and action when we saw Jesus and the chants, crucify him, crucify him. But I would suggest, again, for time's sake, we won't turn there. But today, later, when you go home, go read Acts chapter 19. Acts chapter 19, where the mob in Ephesus goes after Paul and some of the other Christians who are there. And God's word is so clear how the mob just chanted, great is Diana of the Ephesians, great, for 2 hours straight, chanting nothing but great, great. And it also says right there in God's word, it says, and most of the people gathered together didn't even know why they were there. But they just kept chanting because that's mobs in action. That's God's word. You can look it up. And I don't have the time to get into the details. I'm sure most of you followed it if you're at all interested. About the hypocrisy, where you have, on the one hand, you know, a statement that the seriousness of a crime means we must believe the accuser, without the little footnote that says, unless the accuser's going after a Democrat. We don't have to listen and believe them, including one of the main guys in the whole Democrat Party right now, a guy from Minnesota. Very serious charges against him, just crickets. From his own party. Not to mention the ladies who have brought accusations against ex-president Bill Clinton. Don't have to talk about the hypocrisy. We don't have time to develop, although we certainly should, and maybe one day I will, that going all the way back to the scriptures, the law of Moses, the presumption of innocence has been a foundation of any government that's serious about the rule of law. That's why God's law says you got to have two or three witnesses. You can't put someone to death. You can't bring a charge with just one witness. You have to have multiple witnesses. And if you don't have multiple witnesses, much less when you have witnesses who actually deny it and say, no, I don't remember that happening, then you've got an issue. There's a reason that we use the term witch hunt. It goes back to the Salem witch trials. And the idea there is basically, we presume you're guilty, prove your innocence. How do you prove you're not a witch? It's like trying to prove that something didn't happen that didn't happen. And this is serious stuff because I realize in my position, that's all it would take. One accusation, one charge, and then it's, oh, it's he said, she said, who are we supposed to believe? And I would hope that my decades of faithful walk with Jesus Christ with no hint of impropriety along those lines would be believed, but apparently in our world today, that's not good enough. It's an abomination. I talked about one famous book in this country's history. If we wanted to advance to the 20th century, I don't know if it's the most significant novel, but it'd certainly be in the top 10. That's a book called To Kill a Mockingbird, which is a book about an innocent man falsely accused of a terrible sexual crime, and justice was not served. And everyone realized how terrible this was. Now, we have to recognize what's taking place. I mentioned the three pillars: faith, family, the rule of law. Faith and family in America, because of our strong Christian heritage and current Christian practice, even if it is diminishing, still strong, there is no chance in the world that elected politicians nationwide are going to pass legislation to attack the Christian faith and attack the Christian home. Not a chance. And have to stand up to the voter in 2 years of the House, 6 years of the Senate, 4 years of the governor? No way. But there are those who want to attack the faith and family of America, and so they use the courts to do so. They use unelected judges, and the judge pounds his gavel, and he sends out a decree that doesn't just affect the case before him, but affects the whole country. And now, good luck trying to pass legislation to overthrow it. And we see that all the time, don't we? And though not all of them, most of those decisions tend to go against the side of Jesus Christ and truth and righteousness and morality. Not all. Sometimes we win one or two. But you look at the things that have happened in this country, whether it be outlawing prayer, whether it be abortion and all the different gay marriage, all these stuff, it's a judge. They can't pass. Not nationwide. A given state might pass something here or there, but not nationwide. And of course, if your state passes it, you're always free to move to another state in America. That's a beautiful life, liberty, pursuit of happiness, right? A lot of people are pursuing happiness right out of California these days. Highest court of the land, of course, is the Supreme Court. The judge that is being replaced was a moderate swing voter. Brett Kavanaugh has a judicial record of being more strict constitutionalist, i.e. conservative. And the people who know the only way to change and attack this nation is to, through the court system, know if this guy gets on, we're in trouble. And if we think we saw something now, wait in case Justice Ginsburg might pass away while President Trump is in office and he gets to replace her. We are very close to what is an ideological civil war that has been turning violent. You could certainly ask Congressman Scalise, who was gunned down playing softball. You could certainly ask the many people, again, who were punched in the face or assaulted because they went to a rally or wear a hat. And again, to see what's happening, to see a woman like Susan Collins, of all people, be accused of an apologist for rapist. You don't care about rape. I mean, that is just so an outrageous, ridiculous statement. As well as the other women that might be in the Senate on the Republican side. And of course, all those evil white men. But isn't it fascinating that evil white men, if you're a Republican, but if you're Schumer or Blumenthal or Leahy or Durbin, you're a white man too. And we did not see what we used to see with Supreme Court confirmations when a judge was just had a great record and so forth, 90 votes to confirm. Weren't we told that if we had the week-long FBI investigation, we'd get the bomb? How come that didn't turn any Democrat votes? Once they showed, yep, there's no corroboration, there's nothing. Because it was never about that. And it was never about the things that he was. This man was trashed. And his life is forever marred by this, as are his daughters and his wife, who are totally innocent. And everyone with even the slightest bit of morality and integrity ought to be ashamed and ought to speak out against it. But instead, we see congresswomen like Maxine Waters going out. If you see someone, harass them. Don't give them any peace. I don't care if they're in a restaurant or the gas station, whatever. And do you see the entire party on her side condemn her? Say, no, 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 Maxine, we can't go that far. No. Silence is consent. And that's why I fear for the future. And I also fear for the future, and I'm grieved when I see young people in their 20s, let's say, looks like a route right to me, sitting on the steps crying their eyes out as if they were 5 years old and someone took away their favorite toy because a Supreme Court justice just got sworn in, or because Trump got sworn in back in 2016. They were doing it then too. What have they been indoctrinated to fear? What are they so afraid of? It's amazing to me. And when I say indoctrination, I'm not using too strong a word. There's video going on. I saw two different instances, two different places, two different leaders, where in all of this organization, these guys were like giving chants and the people were repeating after me, I will go to this office. I will go to the office. I'm going to do this. I will do this. I couldn't believe what I was seeing. Like a bunch of robots. What is wrong? I mean, I was in my 20s once. And throughout my life, there have been elections where I didn't go to bed happy. There have been Supreme Court nominations I wasn't really thrilled about, but I recognized, well, we got a constitution, this is how it's done, that guy's the president, that's how it goes. And ultimately, I'm a follower of Jesus Christ, and it's not going to change how I live for him. But I also recognize that it does affect the strength of the church in this country. See, the thing about that exit poll I talked about, the people who absolutely say, I got no religious conviction whatsoever, two-thirds of those people vote for the Democrat every election. And they're very loud, and I'm sure they give money. And that's why we're seeing the results that we're seeing. We're not one single Democrat in the Senate, other than a guy, Manchin, who's clearly up for re-election and, you know, scared to death of losing his job in a month. None of them changed their votes, not one. Had to stay united if they want to stay in that party, because those are the people that are calling the shots. You count the third-party voters, and in the last election, only 1 in 4 of those atheists voted for Trump, which doesn't seem to make sense, because aren't we told that Trump is the ungodly, unholy guy? Why do all the ungodly, unholy guys not vote for him? And I'm not, everyone can make up their own opinion about the president, but I tell you what, he's fighting on our side. The side of the church in America, the side of Christianity, the side of the gospel. And my wife and I pray for him daily. That God would give him that wisdom, give him that direction, and give him that courage to fight, because it is a fight, and he has got the authority because of his office to make a big difference for the gospel's sake, as well as the future of this country. And at the end of the day, we understand who's behind all of this desire to destroy the country. Satan. Satan is behind it. And there's a reason then that the atheists are all gravitating to the side that wants to do these measures, make mob rule, keep a good man off the court because he's not going to vote the way they want him to vote, and their dreams are shattered. And I know that there's people, and because I hear it, and people say, look, man, I voted Democrat. I'm a devout Christian. I voted Democrat my whole life. I'm insulted by what you're saying. I recognize that. We're talking about percentages. But I also would hazard to guess that even as a Democrat and a devout Christian, then you're probably not one of those people I was talking about who's sitting on the steps crying your eyes out or punching a guy in the face who walks by you wearing a MAGA hat. Because if it is true of you, then you might re-examine your walk with Jesus. But I understand. But I understand that we're seeing a younger generation that many of them are lost. And they want something to believe in, they want a cause, they want to fight for something. But they were raised by a lost generation. Their parents were atheists. Maybe even their grandparents were atheists. And we are to be witnesses for Jesus Christ as we share the gospel and with our lives, how we live. And to do that, to win souls. Now, can you imagine a missionary who hated the people that he or she went over to serve? You know, went to a foreign nation, but oh, I hate those people. And I really hope that Christianity doesn't grow in this nation where I'm serving. That's absolutely lunacy, isn't it? No missionary would do that. But you know what? If you're not a missionary, if you're not in a foreign land, if you're here, then God says you're a missionary in your own land, aren't you? We're supposed to be witnesses in our own land. So why on earth in our own land would we be afraid of Christianity having influence? You know, I really celebrated that court decision that outlawed prayer. That was a good thing. We don't need that in America. Are you kidding me? It's a far cry from claiming theocracy versus just recognizing life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness with the freedom to have the Ten Commandments or say a prayer at the high school graduation or before the football game. Or some of the other ways that our faith, baking a cake taking wedding photos, whatever it might be. If we do stay in this nation, then we should care about it, and we should recognize that to whom much is given, much is required. And don't buy into this deception about being, quote, too political. Read our Bible. That's why we teach the Bible every week. Read the Bible. See what it says. See what God has to say about government. See how God's people, and read some church history. See how these legends of the Christian faith, how they changed their nations, changed the world in some occasions by their commitment for Jesus Christ, and they're taking a stand against immorality, against evil, against unrighteousness, even if it meant getting, quote unquote, political. Because as the church of Jesus Christ is stronger in commitment, it will grow in numbers, and as the church grows in commitment and numbers, this country will get stronger. It'll be blessed. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. And as this nation gets stronger in the Lord and is blessed, the world will be blessed. I guarantee you, Christians in other countries around the world are praying that America stays strong in Christ, given our influence, both from a political standpoint, military protection, all those kind of things, as well as our Christian standpoint, donations, missionaries, Bibles, all the rest that happen. As we seek to follow Jesus Christ, do what he tells us to do, and not be shamed into silence or apathy because of someone who claims that a real Christian wouldn't do these things. No. God will speak to your heart if you are a real Christian. Do them, and then you can say, actually, a real Christian would do those things because I just did. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for giving us in your word all things that we need to know to live our lives. Not only how to get to heaven, how to have our sins forgiven, and the gift of eternal life, but how to live in this life, in this world, whatever nation we're in. And we know that there's some challenges sometimes as we read the New Testament, given the context of a Roman Empire overruling and all, but yet, Lord, we recognize in the totality of your scripture, you do lead us, you do guide us, and we are blessed here with freedom. Help us to be faithful stewards of it, and bless your people. Give us conviction, give us courage, and Lord, we leave the results in your hand. For the stand is the thing. The battle is the thing. The results are up to you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.